Hey everyone, I was inspired by the movie Midway to go out and visit a real-life World War II aircraft carrier, and that's what we're going to be doing today. This is going to be the USS Hornet positioned in Alameda in California. I do have to note that while this is the USS Hornet, it is CV-12, which did serve in the Second World War and the Cold War, but it is different from the USS Hornet CV-8, which is going to be the one that launched the famous Doolittle Raid and the one that was at Midway. The CV-8 was going to be a Yorktown-class carrier, whereas the one today that we're going to be visiting is going to be an Essex-class, but still for the purposes of getting a sense of what it's like to be an aircraft carrier, this is going to do the trick. So we're going to start off here on the flight deck itself. As you can see, it is quite long, several football fields, and you can imagine back in the day just how crowded it would have been with all sorts of different fighters, torpedo bombers, and whatnot. And these would have been primarily, well, launched and retrieved. The way they would have been launched would have been using these catapult systems, which is basically you harness a plane to this catapult and then you launch it using first hydraulics, and then later on it would have been steam to launch these planes at high speed into the wind and allow them to take off. And this would have been controlled by this deck edge control panel, which allows you to control when you do fire off these catapults. There would have been different crews on board the ship to ensure that the planes are going off at the right time and, you know, navigate them and get them hooked up and take care of all of that. And then on the sides, you would have, you know, the defense people manning the anti-aircraft batteries. And you can imagine just how hectic this would have been if this was in the heat of battle and you're trying to launch ships. And then on top of all that, you're going to be having the control tower right in the center, and they're going to be the ones who are really responsible with what's going on here on the ship deck. So let's go ahead and head on upstairs and discuss what it's like to be in control of this entire system. So now we're going to be up in the main control room up here. You have good visibility down on the flight deck. You have ways to go down and talk to them. And right here, what you're going to be seeing is one of these arrestor control systems. And this is going to be important because what it does is it allows you to successfully catch the ships, or the planes, I should say, as they come in. So there would have been multiple ones of these. And essentially, it's just a wire that you string out across the ship that the plane hooks onto and allows you to slow it down. And each plane has a different weight and a speed that it comes in at, which means you have to adjust the strength of these various systems in order to catch the plane successfully. You don't want it to be so weak that you can't stop the plane, and you don't want it to be too strong to the point where you rip off parts of the plane. And here you can see where they would have been anchored as that particular plane does come in, and the deck crew is going to be here jostling and trying to be sure that they direct it in successfully and are able to catch it. As the plane does come through, you are able to have some redundant systems in place where you can have like nets and other things deployed to be able to catch the particular plane as it came in. This is going to be an example of that net in place, but there were times where that simply wasn't enough and there was risks of pilots going even further, and that posed risks where if you go too far you crash into other ships on the flight deck. So what was introduced later on is going to be this angled deck where you return so that basically, if you miss the catch system, then you continue on and you can actually, you know, you fall off the other side of the ship instead of running into other people on the flight deck and causing an explosion. Instead, what you do is you fall off the ship and ideally you can continue to fly and go again. If not, you fall into the water, you ditch, and you're recovered. So that was something that was introduced later on that was not present in these early days of the Yorktown class ships. So here you can see the angled flight deck, and then you can see the systems for catching the planes as they came in. There's also going to be additional systems that were meant to guide the pilots as they came in, so we'll take a look at that system. And basically it's going to be what's called the Fresnel Lens Optical Landing System, and what it does is depending on the angle that you're looking at it, you see different lights, and when you're at just the right angle it looks a certain way. And so by looking at this, you can line up your trajectory and know if you're angling too high or too low, and then the flight deck up here and the crew up in the tower is going to help you make those adjustments as well to make sure that you have a successful landing. Down here, you know, the people operating here can call other people on the flight deck or make all sorts of arrangements to make sure that everything is running efficiently. To assist in what's going on here, to make order of the chaos, they have this board where they track all the different planes that are up in the air, what their mission is, the time, how they're going to be coming back. They have this bingo system which allows you to track, you know, if the flight deck is compromised, where they can go and land. Then you have this Ouija board, what's called, which allows you to track where the different planes are located on the flight deck, and it's all very confusing and requires great skill to control. But right next to the crew up there is going to be what we're seeing here, which is going to be the navigation team, and they're going to be in charge of locating the ship where it's at. They have all sorts of maps, knobs, and dials that tell you the direction of the ship, the speed, and then they have all sorts of instruments from various eras overlapping that allow you to pinpoint where the ship is at. This goes all the way back to the very primitive technology of the sextant, but that's going to be very useful in an age where, even today, where GPS, you might lose it because of EMP or you want to do a gut check. You have all sorts of different systems that were used throughout the years. The Loran Sea system, which allows you to ping stations on land, and all sorts of stuff here that, again, you know, this doesn't necessarily represent what was present during World War II. Some of this is Cold War era, but all of it, like I said, is superimposed over the years. And what I really liked and what's gonna be displayed here is gonna be the system for kind of assisted plotting of your position. So basically what you have here is this little sort of gizmo. It's like a computer of sorts. And what it is it's basically hooked up to the mechanisms that, track the speed and direction of the ship, such that when you first set this in place, basically you have this this element here that shines a light. So you set it in place at first, and then as the ship moves at a current direction and at a certain speed, that mechanism will adjust. So it does automatic tracking for you as long as you set it in place at first. So let's say, for instance, you've pinpointed the location of the ship, boom, you turn the system on, and now automatically when the aircraft carrier changes course and moves at different speeds, this system will track it. Now, this isn't gonna tell you the whole story. You have to have additional navigators who take into consideration tides or the effect of the wind blowing the ship. So you have all these additional calculations. People would have been tracking the theoretical course of the ship and then making adjustments based on where they think they actually are. So this is stuff that takes a lot of skill and training, and that is definitely still taught today. And then on this map here, you can see some of the missions that were undergone by the USS Hornet, which includes the recovery of the various Apollo missions. There you can see the recovery position of Apollo 12 as the USS Hornet was looking to recover them. So like I said, all kinds of crazy stuff going up here on the navigation deck. And then they're going to be ideally, well, right next to the pilot house, so they know where they're located and they can pass that information on to the pilots. And these are going to be the ones who are, well, driving the aircraft carrier. And you're going to be seeing all sorts of gizmos in here as well. So in the pilot house, primarily you're going to be seeing ways to control your direction. So that's going to be the steering wheel located right in front of us that allows you to turn the rudder. Here you have various dials that tell you your speed. You also can see which way you're angling with the rudder. That's going to be the central dial. And then you have indicators right there that allow you to set like a goal or a limit of what you should be turning, as a reminder not to exceed it. You also have different things like horns that are in place, fog horns or get out of the way type of horns, where you can tell ships to move because you have priority. And then what you also have is, in addition to controlling your direction with the rudder, you then actually get to control the speed. So here you have different ways to increment the engine revolutions in your indicator, or basically how many knots you're advancing. But the interesting thing here is that control system up here in the pilot room is not actually controlling what's going on in the engine room. This is actually just a communication system that, when you set a command, it gets issued down here into the engine room, and the operators down in the engine room then have to, you know, process those orders and input them into the machine. When they do that, what they've done actually then comes back up here and it is reflected up in the pilot house. So this system right here is basically just a means of communicating from up in the pilot house down into the engine room, and you can see one of those down here. So you can imagine the people down here who are actually inputting in the commands to how the vessel performs in terms of speed. They have no idea what's going on for the top. All they read are these commands coming from above. You can imagine just how claustrophobic and scary that would have been to be down in the bowels of the ship, particularly in a battle where torpedoes are thudding off the side of the ship. You hear bombs and all of a sudden you hear the command from your pilot saying full steam ahead or turn, you know, completely to port. Just how crazy all of this was. And a lot of the people were down here, you know, even sleeping, taking long shifts down here during campaigns and on an operation. Here's a way that you can talk to the people in the front of the ship. And then in addition, I did want to mention that there are secondary cons, and actually located throughout the aircraft carrier, there are different ways that you can actually control the ship itself. So for instance, if you lose control of the bridge, there are other locations where you can input commands and control the rudder. Over here, you can actually see the captain's sea cabin. So when the ship was underway, particularly in wartime, he would have been actually sleeping up here much of the time. So basically living the entirety of his career up here in the control room. Here you can see positions for various people who would have been scanning the horizons, taking measurements, doing all sorts of stuff, helping the navigators, helping the pilots, helping the captain. And you know, the pilots here would have been just the enlisted men. The captain actually would not be the one manning the helm there. He would have been sitting up front here with all sorts of subject matter experts. He could pull in his navigators, but the captain would have been sitting on this chair, digesting all the information that's going on here and making the decision about how do I control my vessel. When he's ready, he then issues those commands. There are things here, you know, additional dials that he has to consider. For instance, this tells you basically the level of the entire aircraft carrier that depends on the distribution of men, materials, planes, munitions, all of that that you have to consider. So you can imagine just how much information is involved just keeping the ship afloat during peacetime or even in port. And just imagine what those conditions would have looked like during wartime, where you were actively scanning the horizon. And I'm showing that here just as a reference, or what it would have looked like to manually scan the horizon. And early on, this is stuff that they would have had to do in the World War II era, because though your radar could tell you the direction and relative location of enemy planes coming in, you had to visually confirm what types of planes were they, what are they currently doing, are they dropping bombs, are they dropping torpedoes? How do I have to maneuver my ship? What do I yell into the tube for my pilots to do? If I'm seeing people launch torpedoes, I have to yell in commands to do full speed ahead, you know, turn left, all kinds of stuff like that. So that's how it's worked on here. And you can imagine again what this would have been like to be forced to do this during wartime conditions like the Battle of Midway, where you have so much chaos going on here. Can you really fault some of the decisions that were done by people like Nagumo and others when you have this sort of chaos involved? And so that's why I wanted to bring you this video, so you have an appreciation for what it was like really to man an aircraft carrier under the duress of combat, and even during the duress of just peacetime. And now we're going to descend from, you know, what's going on in the upper level down to the lower levels. This is going to be one of several elevators that is able to bring planes and potentially personnel down to the main, below decks. And this is a place where you would have rolled out with your planes. Presumably you could refuel them, arm them with munitions, do repairs. You would have techs all over the place. And again, I ask you to put yourself in the shoes of the techs down here, where you can't tell what's going on, and all of a sudden, for instance, a bomb comes bursting through the ceiling, embeds itself in the ship, and blows up. This is the chaos of an aircraft carrier. And here I'm showing you a little bit of the crew that were responsible. I'm also going to be showing you some of the planes. So for instance, this is going to be one of the Wildcats. I believe it's going to be one of the primary fighters that was involved for the Navy during the Second World War. Just wanted to show you a little bit of the scale and the perspective and how many of these would have been crammed down into the ship itself. Here's going to be one of the Avenger bombers carrying a torpedo, I believe. And again, it's important, at least for me, to get a sense of the scale of this, and really realize how dwarfed humans are in terms of the size of the machinery of war at this time, and just the humbling feeling you have, and just what it takes, how many people it takes to man one of these aircraft carriers. And when you pull it off successfully, I mean, these are the results. It speaks for itself. Here you can see the amount of planes and ships sunk by the USS Hornet, the CV-12. But it wasn't just sinking enemy vessels. The USS Hornet was actually involved, as I mentioned before, with the recovery of elements of the space program. So tracking down the astronauts who came down in the capsules from their space missions, so sending out helicopters to go recover them. So a huge endeavor all throughout. And, you know, we've been focusing a lot on what it's like to be up on the flight deck or in the control room or in the pilot room. And so what we're going to be doing here next is going to be descending further down in the levels of the ship, down into the bowels, to really get an understanding of what it's like to live aboard the ship. And the main thing that I want you to understand, it basically is a city, because aircraft carriers were deployed for so long overseas, they really have to be self-reliant. So you're going to be seeing that, for instance, here with a full-blown medical bay where you can see all sorts of doctor's rooms here just for your standard everyday check-ins. If you had a sprain or if you had maybe an illness, you can get checked out and do your routine doctor's work here. But then as you look around in these rooms, you start to see things that get a little bit more intense. You can see surgical bays, you can see radiology locations, all sorts of stuff going on. And again, I urge you to put yourself in the mindset of what it's like to be here during wartime, where you have bloodied pilots or deck crew brought down here for emergency help. All the while the ship is lurching in the seas, you have bombs going off, torpedoes thudding off the side of the carrier. Just imagine what it's like to be in these conditions. It's already stressful enough to be a doctor and a surgeon. Just imagine what it's like to be in these conditions during wartime. It's incredible what the men and women of the armed services went through. And then over here, you're going to be seeing some of the bedding. This is going to be places where you see them stacked two or three deep. And these are going to be the traditional accommodations for most of the enlisted men aboard these aircraft carriers. If you're an executive officer, though, you do get the luxury suite. And so, he gets his own table. And then a little bit further, you get to see the amazing, you know, emperor's quarters in here that are rather stingy by our civilian standards. But for an aircraft carrier, this is the king's palace. So quite impressive. And then as we move along, we're going to be moving into the pantry where you can see the kitchen, all sorts of preparations that have to be done here. And again, keep in mind the scope and scale of the preparations that are involved here. You have an entire city's worth of people that come down here and eat, and they have to make sure that everyone is getting the right amount of meals, that they have the right type of nutrition, make sure that everyone is performing at peak capacity and they are fed well. And for instance, here we're going to be looking at one of the logs, and what it does show is the type of food that's consumed, how much of it, so 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 servings, special notes. So a shout out to everyone, including the cooks and the chefs and the staff involved in, you know, bustling and cleaning and doing everything that, you know, maintains this entire system that's operating at peak capacity during the war and during peacetime. And then over here a little bit further, we do see some of the mess hall. And again, as I was walking through here, and I urge you to keep in mind, a lot of people here might have had their last meals before going out on missions. And so it's quite the humbling experience to be able to kind of commune with the past by being in these locations. But again, it's not all, you know, just sadness. There's also a lot of happiness, I'm sure, that took place here. And I'm going to be going out and exploring various corners of the aircraft carrier. Here you can see, for instance, there is a bathroom, and there's going to be another location here where you can do your laundry. Again, the emphasis is that you're not just fighting a war, you're living aboard this aircraft carrier, and that's very much evident. And I'm not going to be able to show you every single room in this tour. There is just so much to be seen, but I did want to pick out some of the highlights. And another one of these is going to be one of several ready rooms, and this is going to be, you know, the iconic ones that you see in Top Gun or the things that you see in the movie Midway. And this is basically where the pilots come in or others come in and they get debriefed on the mission at hand. These are, you know, these are very dramatic scenes. And so you have the podium set up. Behind it, you have the various maps and charts that are used to describe the operation at hand. And then you see there's going to be, you know, boards flanking this where you can note the times and the departures and the teams involved and all that. And again, I urge you to put yourself in the shoes of the people who were here in the past, what it was like, the nerves that would have been shaken when people were in these seats planning very pivotal operations, for instance, aboard the USS Hornet, like the Doolittle Raid, and just how crazy it is to put yourself in their shoes and just imagine the stakes and the weight on your shoulders as you're in that debriefing room. It really takes great courage. So I really hope you guys enjoyed this tour. That's about it for my video. I hope you guys enjoyed. And stay tuned for more. And I will see you in the next one. Thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.